Cheers, guys. Epix911, welcome to the Tuesday, August 29th, 2017 edition of VR News. With that, let's jump into the news, starting with this from Bethesda. Some people still wondering why no DLC with Fallout 4 for the virtual reality version when Skyrim did get it. Well, we've got an answer and it's pretty straightforward. It comes from Pete Hines, who of course is Bethesda's vice president of marketing. He spoke to the folks at Upload VR, the QuakeCon event last week, and explained exactly why Fallout 4 won't include any DLC, saying, "We had done some work already with Skyrim and the Game of the Year edition that already had all of that stuff. It was more that that was the code base and starting point for doing the VR version, and that simply did not exist for Fallout. What we started with was just a base game for Fallout 4, whereas for Skyrim, Game of the Year with all the DLC. So that's why those versions look like those versions." He was also asked if Fallout 4 might get DLC added on at a later date. Hines replied, "I don't know." Next story. This is an update on the Vuze camera. We last looked at it about 5 months ago. It's a 360-degree 4K camera. Manufacturer Humaneyes Technology today announcing that they have a series of software and hardware enhancements coming up over the next few months. First up, new apps for both Android and iOS that are going to allow things like videographers to preview content as well as change exposure settings. Other updates like a beta of Vuze VR Studio for Mac users that promises near real-time processing. And an update to the main software for PC users that's going to automate image stitching. On the hardware side of things, they've also announced a waterproof case. This is for their small camera and it's going to be to allow full underwater use, so scuba diving, activities like that. CEO Shahar Bin Nun promising those and additional features live by early 2018. The developer of Until Dawn announcing a couple of new virtual reality titles. The first one is called The Inpatient. This one is going to hit store shelves and the PlayStation Store November 21st of this year. Looks to be a horror game, which in my opinion is fantastic because after Until Dawn and Resident Evil, I am definitely up for more horror games on the PSVR. I think it's a genre that has the type of controls and tracking requirements that, you know what, work just fine for horror games. And I also can't say I'm tired of horror settings like derelict houses or insane asylums, at least not yet anyways. Second game that they announced is called Bravo Team. This one is going to be released December 5th, likewise stores and digitally. Now, I used to love for PC Ghost Recon and Rainbow Six. And what I loved about those games was the fact that it was more simulation than action-y. Unlike Call of Duty style games where you had almost the equivalent of hit points. In these, very often, a kill shot was a kill shot, and they were also very tactical, which I liked. Bravo Team looks to be more like the Ghost Recon and Rainbow Six style game than Call of Duty. At least that's my hope, based on what I'm seeing from the trailer anyways. If anybody out there knows that to be not true, let me know in the comments below. With this next story, guys, every once in a while I get twinges of sadness about my beloved Aliens-themed arcade cabinet. Asked many times, I've answered the question, I had no choice. It simply wasn't built to be modular, and I had to destroy it, but I salvaged all the parts. And I'm usually good for weeks, and then I get a reminder. A reminder like this damn game. It's called Marble Land, and it's from Romanian-based studio DVS Technologies. If that isn't enough, it's also a nice reminder about aging. And I say that because the author described this game almost with wonderment at how original this game appeared, when really, it's Marble Madness in virtual reality. Marble Madness, of course, not mentioned even once in the article. Clearly, a VR version of the classic Atari arcade game from 1984 that date probably telling you everything you need to know and why this writer wasn't aware of that. And that's okay, but you know, if there is history, include it. Here's the original, which was one of my favorite trackball games to play on said cabinet. Again, the reminder, pain, all that kind of stuff. Now, you can see that alongside the modern reimagining of the game. To me, if the price is right, I will definitely be picking this up. If anything, just for pure nostalgia to be reborn. We should see the game get released before the holiday season for both virtual reality and traditional monitors. This next story, guys, I've talked about this product and I've been highly skeptical about it in the past, and it's from MVR Global. This is the virtual reality HMD that's going to run a miniaturized tablet and basically stream AAA games from an Xbox One, for example, to the device and allow you to play those games in virtual reality. So this updated article was on VR Focus, and as with before, highly skeptical. My main issue with this technology is the way that it fundamentally works. Let me explain. So they include their own gamepad style with it. Now, this is obviously my PlayStation 4 Persona controller, but their version of that has two things unique to its design. It's got a little ROM section on the bottom where games are stored. And what I mean by that is patches to games to basically bend them to VR will or make them 360 effectively. So there's going to basically be a patch for every game that's going to work. The gamepad is going to have a wire. Otherwise, it's tetherless. It's a wireless headset. But there is a wire that runs from the gamepad to the back of the HMD, and that is responsible for basically shifting between turning in-game with the analog nub, and I believe it was the right or the left, one of the two. When you engage the shifted function, instead of turning your head HMD, like turning your HMD is going to be where that movement takes place. So if you're playing a first-person game, you'd be switching back and forth a lot because you wouldn't want to aim with your head necessarily. You'd want to aim with the gamepad. So that's a big challenge, right? But not the biggest. And here's why this, to me, I'm just very skeptical about it. To me, it comes across like a Vorpex. Basically, that is what it does. Vorpex working alongside a Zim 4 type device. Let me explain. Anybody who doesn't know, this is the Zim 4, and it's basically designed to provide mouse and keyboard with console games. A lot of people call this a cheat for online play, etc. I just liked it and use it because I like to use mouse and keyboard on first-person games, generally single-player games. But how it works is very similar to how I imagine and how it's described the MVR works, in that, like the MVR, the Zim has to be patched for each game because turning sensitivity is going to be different for every single game. And sometimes the mouse and keyboard works good. I won't ever say excellent or amazing, but good. Most of the time, it's average or slightly below average, in my opinion, but well worth the money I paid for it. However, virtual reality, I see that being more like a Vorpex experience. There's going to be the odd game where it might be passable, but is it going to blow your socks off? Probably not. Now, I absolutely stand to be corrected, but based on the history of this company, they failed their original Kickstarter. Nobody seems to have been interested in acquiring them. They basically have gone unacquired for the last year. If this was truly as mind-blowing as they make it sound in the sales pitch, wouldn't somebody have stepped up to the plate to scoop it up for some really easy AAA published games in VR? You'd think so. It didn't happen. And thus, my skepticism. Let me know your guys' thoughts on that. Other than that, that's what I got for this Tuesday, guys. Almost Wednesday. As always, cheers.